وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول
الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. We're now inshallah ta'ala going to go into the fourth hadith in the explanation of the kitab Shamaa'il Muhammadiyyah written by al-Imam Abu Isa al-Tirmidhi rahimahullah. الحديث الرابع حدثنا محمود بن غيلان قال حدثنا وكيع قال حدثنا سفيان عن أبي إسحاق عن البراء بن عازب قال ما رأيت من ذي لمة في حلة حمراء أحسن من رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم له شعر يضرب منكبيه بعيد ما بين المنكبين لم يكن بالقصير ولا بالطويل. This is the hadith, inshallah ta'ala, we're going to take bi-idhnillah al-kareem today. This hadith is authentic, it's sahih. And some of the scholars, they looked at Abi Ishaq as-Sabee'i, who's in the chain of narration. The person who narrated from Abi Ishaq as-Sabee'i is Sufyan al-Thawri. And we took in our previous hadith that if Shu'bat ibn Hajjaj, Abu Bistam al-Ataki, or Sufyan al-Thawri narrates from Abi Ishaq as-Sabee'i, rest assured that that narration is fine and there's no problem with it. And the Imam of Jarh wa Ta'deel, Yahya ibn Ma'in, he said, أَثْبَتُ أَصْحَابِ أَبِي إِسْحَاقَ شُعْبَةُ وَالثَّوْرِيُّ. The strongest people who took from Abi Ishaq al-Sabi'i are Shu'bah and al-Thawri. The previous hadith was Shu'bah that took from Abi Ishaq al-Sabi'i that we mentioned. And in today's class, inshallah ta'ala, or in today's hadith, the person who narrated from Abi Ishaq al-Sabi'i is Sufyan al-Thawri. Another question some of you might ask is, how do I know that the Sufyan here is Sufyan al-Thawri? And I'll mention that inshallah ta'ala when I come into the biography of Sufyan al-Thawri. Sufyan ibn Uyayna, if he narrates from Abi Ishaq al-Sabi'i, there is a weakness. It's good to avoid it. Okay? Also, this hadith, al-Imam At-Tirmidhi also narrated it in his Jami' and he graded it to be Hasan Sahih. He said it's a hadith which is Hasan Sahih. At-Tayalisi also narrated it. Ibn Abi Shayba narrated it. Ahmad narrated it. Bukhari narrated it. Muslim narrated it. Abu Dawud narrated it. Ibn Majah narrated it. Nasa'i narrated it. Abu Ya'la narrated it. Ibn Hibban also narrated it. And Al-Bayhaqi rahimahullah. So this hadith, inshallah ta'ala, is sahih. First point that we want to take from the 11 points that we're going to take regarding this hadith, there is 11 fawaid, 11 benefits that we're going to take from this hadith, inshallah ta'ala. The first benefit. حَدَّثَنَا مُحْمُودُ بْنُ غَيْلَانٍ. Some of the nusakhs I came across, it doesn't start with حَدَّثَنَا مُحْمُودُ بْنُ غَيْلَانٍ. It says ثَنَا. And remember, ثَنَا is a rams. It's a symbol that takes the place of حَدَّثَنَا. That's important that we understand it. So even if we did see ثَنَا written there, we would understand it means حَدَّثَنَا. That's how we will read it as. But the copy that I'm relying on, it writes حَدَّثَنَا. But some nusakh say ثَنَا written like that. And I'm only mentioning it so you know it, بإذن الله الكريم. But either way, it's the same. Whether it's written as ثَنَا or حَدَّثَنَا, it's always read as حَدَّثَنَا. Who's this محمود بن غيلان? Who is he? Muhammad ibn Gahylan al-Adawiyyu, al-Imam al-Dhahabiyyu, he said about him in Sir Alam al-Nubala, he said, al-Imam al-Hafidhu al-Hujjatu Abu Ahmadin al-Adawiyyu, Mawlahum, al-Marwaziyyu, min a'immati al-Athari. Al-Imam al-Dhahabiyyu gave him high praise. He said to him, he's a Hafidh. Again, if I remind you all, brothers and sisters, Hafidh is a person who the minimum ahadith he memorized is 100,000 ahadiths. Matnan wa isnadan. 100,000 ahadiths which the chain and the wordings, you've memorized it. 100,000 at least. If you memorize more than that, alhamdulillah. Al-Imam Muslim, rahimahullah, on the other hand, he selected from 600,000 hadiths, 4,000 that he wrote his sahih from. Al-Imam Muslim, rahimahullah. So that means he's memorized all of that from memory. Al-Imam al-Tirmidhi is also min al-Hufadh, and also Mahmood ibn Gahylan is a hafidh in hadith. He's memorized more than 100,000 hadiths. Mahmood ibn Gahylan, who are the people he took knowledge from? From them is Sufyan ibn Uyayna. He took from him. He also took from Al-Fadl ibn Musa, Al-Walid ibn Muslimin, Abi Muawiyah, Waqee ibn Jarrah al-Ru'asi, Yahya ibn Sulaymin, al-Ta'ifiyu, Abdul Razak ibn Hamam al-San'ani, wa tabaqatihim, and those on that level. He, rahimahullah, Dhahabi said about him, he said, وَكَانَ مِنْ فُرْسَانِ الْحَدِيثِ. Dhahabi said about him, he's from the Fursan. Fursan is the forefront riders of this field of hadith. And he's from the shuyukh of Al-Imam al-Tirmidhi. Who narrated from him? Al-Jama'ah. Brothers and sisters, I use this word a lot, and I loosely translate it in English as the Jama'ah narrated from him. Jama'ah originally means, when the scholars of hadith use that word, when they say rawalahu al-jama'ah, if you ever read that in books of hadith, you know it means a'immatu sita. Rawalahu al-jama'ah means a'immatu sita. The six scholars of hadith narrated from him. All of the jama'ah narrated from him, siwa Abi Dawood. Abu Dawood didn't narrate from him. Abu Zur'at al-Razi also took from him. Abu Hatim al-Razi took from him. Okay? Al-Hassan ibn Sufyan, al-Mutayyin, and also al-Haytham ibn Khalafin, and Abu al-Qasim al-Baghawiyan, Ibrahim ibn Abi Talibin, Abu al-Abbas al-Sarrajan, Ja'far ibn Ahmad ibn Nasrin, and Muhammad ibn Shadani, ibn Khuzaymah, wa khalqun la yuhsaw. People we cannot count, they all took from him. Ahmad ibn Hanbal, he said about him, a'arifuhu bil hadith. I know this man to be hadith. I know him to be from the people of hadith. And then he said, sahibu sunnah, he's a person of the sunnah. Qad hubisa bisabab al-Qur'an. And he was imprisoned, Ahmad said. Al-Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, he said, qad hubisa bisabab al-Qur'an. He was imprisoned because of the fitna of the Qur'an. Some people, they said the Qur'an is created, right? They brought this fitna into the Muslims. And some great scholars of Islam took a harsh and tough position regarding regarding this issue. And Mahmood ibn Gahylan was from those people. My brothers and sisters, as a side benefit, when the fitna of Khalqul Qur'an came, it was a distinguishing factor between who was Ahlul Sunnah and who wasn't. When you read the tarajim of the scholars, you will find if he was alive at that time, they used that to determine what side was he on. Ahmad ibn Hanbal used to use that fitna to know who was on the haq and who wasn't. Rahimahullah ta'ala. And that's why he said, a'arifu bil hadith. Sahibu sunnatin qad hubisa bisabab al-Qur'an. He was imprisoned because of his position regarding the Qur'an. He died in the month of Ramadan when the year was sanata 39 wa 200 and 39 Hijri. He passed away. Qala haddathana waki'un. The second imam that's mentioned in the chain is Waqee ibn Jarrah, ibn Mulayh, ibn Adi, ibn Farasi, ibn Jumata, ibn Sufyan, ibn al-Harith, ibn Amr, ibn Ubaid, ibn al-Ruwas, al-Imam al-Hafidh, muhaddith al-Iraqi, Abu Sufyan al-Ruwasi, al-Kufiyu ahad al-A'lam. Waqee ibn Jarrah al-Ruwasi, his full name is Waqee ibn al-Jarrah ibn Mulayh, ibn Adi, ibn Faras, ibn Jumjuma, ibn Sufyan, ibn al-Harith, ibn Amr, ibn Ubaid, ibn al-Ru'as. Al-Imam al-Dhahabi, we said about him, al-Imam, al-Hafidh, muhaddith al-Iraq, his kunya is Abu Sufyan, al-Ru'asiyu al-Kufiyu, ahad al-A'lam. He's from Kufa, that's where he resided in. And by the way, he passed away on his way to Mecca, Waqee ibn Jarrah al-Ru'asi. And he was born Sanata 129 Hijriya, as Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal said. He heard from many people. Some of them are Hisham ibn Urwata and Sulaiman al-A'mash, يعني Sulaiman ibn Mihran, Ismail ibn Abi Khalidin and ibn Awn and ibn Jurayjan, Dawood al-Awdi and Yunus ibn Abi Ishaq, Aswad ibn Shaybanin and Hisham ibn al-Ghazin, الأوزاعي عن جعفر بن برقان عن زكريا بن أبي زائدة عن طلحة بن عمرو المكي عن فضيل بن غزوان عن أوس حنظلة بن أبي سفيان عن أبان بن صمعتة أبان بن عبد الله البجلي أبان بن يزيد إبراهيم الفضل المخزومي إبراهيم بن يزيد الخوزي إدريس بن يزيد عن إسماعيل بن رافع المدني عن إسماعيل بن سليمان الأزرق عن إسماعيل بن أبي صفيراء عن أوس إسماعيل بن مسلم العبدي and many other great imams that he took from. From the people he took from is Sufyan al-Thawri, Shu'bat ibn Hajjaj, and Israel and Shuraik, wa khalqin kathir. The people that took from him are many, and that's Sufyan al-Thawri. Sufyan, even though he's from his teachers, he took from him and he took from him. Which in ilm al-hadith is riwayat al-akabiri anil asagir, as they call it in ilm al-hadith. When the senior takes from the younger. And in ilm al-hadith, a student, the teacher takes a hadith from him. Like Imam al-Bukhari, who did, Bukhari took from Tirmidhi. Tirmidhi is a student, Bukhari is the teacher. And the asal of riwayat al-akabir anil asagir, the asal for it, is what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did to Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. When he said, iqra alayya. And then Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, and he said, aqra alayka wa qad unzil. Do you want me to read the Qur'an on you when the Qur'an came down on you? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, uhibbu an asma'aha min ghayri. I love to hear the Qur'an from other than myself. And then Abdullah ibn Mas'ud recited Surah Al-Nisa. When he reached the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he said, فَكَيْفَ إِذَا جِئْنَا مِنْ كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ بِشَهِيدٍ وَجِئْنَا بِكَ عَلَى هَؤُلَاءِ شَهِيدًا يَوْمَئِذٍ يَوَدُّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا وَعَصَوُا الرَّسُولَ لَوْ تُسَوَّى بِهِمُ الْأَرْضُ وَلَا يَكْتُمُونَ اللَّهَ حَدِيثَ الْآيَةِ. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, and he said, I looked at the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, فَإِذَا عَيْنَاهُ تَضْرِفَانِ. His eyes were just watering, gushing with tears. So the scholars, they took from that, the Prophet listened to Qur'an and heard it from Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. Scholars, they took from there that it's permissible for a senior person to want to listen to and take from the person who is what? Lower than him in knowledge. عَلَى كُلِّ حَلْ سُفْيَانِ الثَّوْرِي was أَحَدُ شُيُوخِهِ, one of his teachers. Abdullah ibn Mubarak and Fudayl ibn Musa al-Sinani and Yahya ibn Adam and Abdul Rahman ibn Mahdi and al-Humaydi, Abdullah ibn Zubayr and Musaddid ibn Sarhadin and Ahmed ibn Hanbal. All of these people are people who took from him. And Ibn Ma'in and Ishaq and Abu Shaybah, Abu Qaythamah Zuhair ibn Harbin and Abu Quraybin and Ibn Numayr and Abu Hisham al-Rafi'i. All of these are the people that took from him. Yahya ibn Yaman, he said, لَمَّا مَاتَ السُّفْيَانَ الثَّوْرِيُّ جلس وكيع الموضعه. The station of وكيع بن جراح is the following. وكيع بن جراح الرؤاسي, he occupied the seat of سفيان الثوري. يعني when سفيان الثوري passed away, وكيع بن جراح الرؤاسي took the place of his place. And some scholars, they considered سفيان الثوري rahimahullah to be even more knowledgeable in fiqh than Abu Hanifa rahimahullah. Imagine that, Waqee occupied his seat, as we're going to see inshallah ta'ala later. Al-Fadl ibn Muhammad al-Sha'rani, he said, سَمِعْتُ يَحْيَ بْنُ أَكْثَمٍ. I heard يَحْيَ بْنُ أَكْثَمٍ saying, سَحِبْتُ وَكِيعًا. I befriended Waqee فِي الْحَضَرِ وَالسَّفَرِ. I traveled with him and I stayed with him as a resident. وَكَانَ يَصُومُ الدَّهْرَ. The whole year he was fasting. وَيَخْتِمُ الْقُرْآنَ كُلَّ لَيْلَةٍ. And every night he would finish the Qur'an once. I like a benefit that I took from Dhahabi Sir Alam al-Nubala. Dhahabi at that point, he stopped the mentioning of this and he went into the following. He said, هَذِي عِبَادَةٌ يُخْضَعُ لَهَا. He said, this action of Waqee ibn Jarrah is something you humble yourself for. يُخْضَعُ لَهَا وَلَكِنَّهَا مِنْ مِثْلِ إِمَامٍ مِنَ الْأَئِمَّةِ الْأَثَرِيَّةِ. But to come, this action to come from an imam from the a'imma al-athariya who followed athar, mafdulatun, it's not a good choice that he took. Why? فَقَدْ صَحَّ نَهْيُهُ عَلَيْهِ صَلَاةُ وَسَلَامُ. The prohibition came from the Prophet عَنْ الصَّوْمِ الدَّهْرِ, to fast the whole entire year. وَصَحَّ عَنْهُ, and also it came from the Prophet عَلَيْهِ صَلَاةُ وَسَلَامُ أَنَّهُ نَهَى أَنْ يُقْرَأَ الْقُرْآنُ. The Prophet prohibited for someone to read the Qur'an فِي أَقَلَّ مِنْ ثَلَاثٍ, in less than 3 days. وَالدِّينُ يُسْرٌ, Dhahabi said. The religion is simple. ومتابعه السنه اولى. And to follow the sunnah takes precedence. فرضي الله عن وكيع. May Allah have mercy upon وكيع. وأين مثل وكيع. And where can we find like the likes of وكيع. This really benefits us something very beneficial, brothers and sisters. And that is the importance of following the athar, the Qur'an and the sunnah. يعني look at Dhahabi. He did not belittle Waqee ibn Jarrah al-Ru'asi. He honored him, praised him. With that being said, lakin, he pointed out what was the right position a person should take. The person we follow and we take his statements unrestrictedly is the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Everybody else, kullun yu'khadhu min qawlihi wa yurad. Everybody else, his statement is either taken or rejected. But what we understand, brothers, is zallatu alimin, this mistake that comes from a scholar, or the error that comes from a scholar, it's not permissible for us to use it as a means to target his honor. We look what he said at the ending, فَرَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْ وَكِيعٍ وَأَيْنَ مِثْلُ وَكِيعٍ. May Allah have mercy upon Waqee'. Where are we when it comes to Waqee'? Ibn Ammar, he said, مَا كَانَ بِالْكُوفَةِ فِي زَمَانِ وَكِيعٍ. At the time of Waqee' ibn Jarrah al-Ru'asi in Kufa, there was no one like him. أَفْقَهُ وَلَا أَعْلَمُ بِالْحَدِيثِ مِنْ وَكِيعٍ. That had more knowledge in hadith and had more fiqh than Waqee' ibn Jarrah al-Ru'asi. وَكَانَ جِهْبِذًا سَمِعْتُهُ يَقُولُ. He was a jihbid, يعني he reached a pinnacle of knowledge. قَوِيٌّ فِي الْحِفْظِ. I heard him say, Ibn Ammar, he said, I heard him one day saying, مَا نَظَرْتُ فِي كِتَابٍ. I haven't looked at a book. مُنْذُ خَمْسَ عَشَرَةَ سَنَةً. 15 years, I've never looked at a note. I've never looked at anything. It's in my head. إِلَّا فِي صَحِيفَةٍ يَوْمًا. One day, I just looked at a page on somewhere and I just turned the page over. It's, يعني, they said about Waqee', his hifd was so strong that he would come and he would sit down and he would just talk. He would narrate everything from his hifd. Sufyan al-Thawri one day saw Waqee' ibn Jarrah al-Ru'asi. And then he said, لا يموت هذا الرؤاسي. This Ru'asi is not going to die حتى يكون له شأن. He's going to die and this boy is going to have something. This boy is not, I see something in him, he said. And guess what, brothers? فمات سفيان. Sufyan passed away. وجلس وكيع مكانه. And he sat in his position. The ulama have firasa. They can see the person, the student, and the ability of the student and the knowledge that a student can possess. Waqee' passed away, rahimahullah ta'ala. There are three views is when he passed away. Some scholars, they say he bypassed away 196, some say 97, some say 98. Rahimahullah. And he passed away في الطريق مكة, on his way to Mecca. I looked at all of the copies that came in Shamaa’il Muhammadiyyah. All of them, they mention حدثنا Waqee'. None of the copies mention حدثنا Waqee' ibn Jarrah. So that's a fa'ida that I just wanted to mention there, inshallah ta'ala. The third point, inshallah ta'ala, that I want us to take, inshallah ta'ala, is حدثنا سفيان. قال حدثنا سفيان عن أبي إسحاق. Which is the third fa'ida that we're going to take, inshallah ta'ala. By the way, brothers and sisters, the Sufyan here is Sufyan al-Thawri. How do I know? And that it's not Sufyan ibn Uyayna. The reason is because I went to Jami' al-Tirmidhi by Imam al-Tirmidhi, because I know he narrated this hadith in his Jami'. And I looked at it, and Tirmidhi mentions it in the Senate that it is what? That it is Sufyan al-Thawri, not Sufyan ibn Uyayna. That's number one. So any some of the shurrah I came across, some of the explanations that I came across, where there was a taraddud, they were doubting, is it Ibn Uyayna? Is it Thawri? In simple terms, reject it and dismiss it. There's no need to worry about it. It is Sufyan al-Thawri. Who is Sufyan al-Thawri? Sufyan ibn Sa'id ibn Masruqin al-Thawri, that's his name. His lengthy name is Sufyan ibn Sa'id ibn Masruq al-Thawri, and ibn Habib, ibn Rafi', ibn Abdillah, ibn Mawhibat, ibn Ubayyin. ابن عبد الله ابن منقذ ابن نصر ابن الحارث ابن ثعلبة ابن عامر ابن ملكان ابن ثور ابن عبد منات ابن أد ابن طابخة ابن إلياس ابن مضر ابن نزار ابن معدن ابن عدنان. That is the nasab that Ibn Abi Dunya mentioned for him, which he goes to the Prophet's lineage عليه الصلاة والسلام. Dhahabi said about him, Shaykh al-Islam, Imam al-Huffaz, Sayyid al-Ulama il-Amilina fi zamanihi, Abu Abdullah al-Thawri al-Kufi al-Mujtahid. Sufyan al-Thawri was a mujtahid mutlaq. He was a mujtahid. He had a madhab, Sufyan al-Thawri. That's number one. In terms of fiqh, he was a mujtahid. Hadithna, he was min al-Huffaz. Not only that, he was an Amir al-Mu'minin al-Hadith. Rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'a. He was born the year by unanimous agreement that all of the scholars unanimously agree that he was born sanata sab'in wa tis'ina. Brothers and sisters, a side benefit, sometimes in books of hadith you're going to read scholars mentioning the biography of imam, and they will mention his birth when he was born. It's always as a side benefit to always go and find out his birth was unanimously agreed upon. The reason for that is because it's rare that the scholars agree on a person's birth. Majority of the times there's khilaf. The reason for that, Ibn Daqiq al-Eid points it out. He says that because when the person is born into this earth, he's not of no value yet. He hasn't earned any value for people to consider his birth. Lakin when he is dying or passing away and he's an alim, an imam, that year everyone will know it. That tariq is written for the ulama and the scholars and the people of knowledge. They document it because he died and he left behind a legacy. Because you come into this world nothing, you shouldn't leave the way you came in. Should have been some value, some khair for the Muslims to benefit from. So here, rahimahullah, it was sanata sab'in wa tis'ina ittifaqan, by unanimous agreement. Al-Imam al-Dhahabi, he said about him, وَطَلَبَ الْعِلْمَ, he sought knowledge, وَهُوَ حَدَثٌ, he went and sought knowledge when he was a young child, بِاعْتِنَاءِ وَالِدِهِ, his father gave consideration to him. And his father is a muhaddithun sadiqun, Sa'id ibn Masruq al-Thawri, his father. His father, by the way, is from the students of Sha'bi, and Khaythamah ibn Abd al-Rahman. His father is considered from the thiqat al-kufiyin, the reliable people of Kufa. And he's considered from the young tabi'in, his father. All of the six books of hadith, Bukhari, Muslim, Abi Dawud, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, Nasa'i, all of them narrated from him. They all have him in their chains. All of them. Someone like Sufyan al-Thawri, no one would dismiss him. Also, his own children, he has a son called Sufyan as well, narrated from him. Umar, Mubarak, Shu'bat ibn al-Hajjaj, Abu Bistam al-Ataki narrated from him. Zaida, Abu al-Ahwas, Abu Awana, Umar ibn Ubaid al-Tanafisi, and many others, they narrated from him. He has many teachers that he took from. Rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'a. The number are too much that he took from. What's funny is that Abu Bakr al-Faraj ibn al-Jawzi mentioned that his teachers are 20,000. Or he said more than 20,000. Annahum akthara min 20 alfan. Al-Imam al-Dhahabi pointed something out here. And I think this is a benefit that students of hadith will always benefit from, which is, Dhahabi mentioned something, you write it in a book and you keep it somewhere, because you will always remember it. It's a fa'ida. Dhahabi says, وَهَذَا مَدْفُوعٌ مَمْنُوعٌ. That statement of Abu al-Faraj ibn al-Jawzi is rejected and it's turned down. We don't accept it. فَإِن بَلَغُوا أَلْفًا فَبِالْجَهْدِ. He said, if we go as far and stretch it out, Sufyan al-Thawri's teachers will only reach 1,000, he said. وَمَا عَلِمْتُ أَحَدًا مِّنَ الْحُفَّاظِ. This is where the fa'ida I found. He said, وَمَا عَلِمْتُ أَحَدًا مِّنَ الْحُفَّاظِ. He said, I don't know anyone from the scholars of hadith, the Huffaz. رَوَى عَنْهُ عَدَدٌ أَكْثَرَ مِّنْ مَالِكٍ. That narrated more from Imam Malik. Malik has the most when it comes to the people he narrated from. And look what he said. وَبَلَغُوا بِالْمَجَاهِيلِ وَبِالْكَذَّابِينَ. And even Malik, if we add the liars and the weak people and the unknown people, all of them, if we put them together, he reaches 1,400. And Dhahabi, when he says that, you know he's an imam in tarajim of the scholars, he knows the narrators, he knows all of that, rahimahullah ta'ala. And he has tatabbu'. That we mentioned that is powerful. Abdurrahman ibn Mahdi, Shaykh al-Imam al-Shafi'i, al-Imam al-Shafi'i's Shaykh, Abdurrahman ibn Mahdi, by the way, brothers, is the man who told al-Imam al-Shafi'i to write the Kitab al-Risala. He was the one who encouraged him. Abdurrahman al-Mahdi, thiqatun abid. Abdurrahman ibn Mahdi said, ما رأت عيني, my two eyes have not seen, أفضل من أربعة, أو مثل أربعة. My eyes have never seen, anyone better than these four, or even equal to these four. ما رأيت أحفظ للحديث الثوري. I haven't come across anyone who had memorized, who was strongest in hadith than Imam Sufyan al-Thawri. ولا أشد تقشعا من شعبة. And I haven't seen anyone who had more تقشف, both ways you can say it, than شعبة. تقشف means, by the way, somebody whose clothing is very simple. يعني متواضع. When you see him, he doesn't dress. يعني زاهد. شعبة is very زاهد in his clothing and the way he appeared. ولا أعقل من مالك. And no one smarter than Imam Malik. ولا أنصح للأمة من ابن المبارك. And I've never seen anyone more sincere for the Ummah than Ibn Mubarak. Ibn Mubarak, Abdullah ibn Mubarak, inshallah ta'ala, when his turn comes, we'll speak about him. There was ulama, like Ismail ibn Ulayya and other great imams, they were all on the wages of Abdullah ibn Mubarak's money. He used to pay for the salaries. And he used to always say to them, don't take the money from the leader. Whatever you do, don't take it. It was mentioned Abdullah ibn Mubarak, his sincerity to the Ummah. That one day he found out that one of his students, Abdullah ibn Mubarak, had been imprisoned because of debt. Couldn't pay the money, so he got imprisoned. So Abdullah ibn Mubarak requested for his student, he said, where is he? They said, Shaykh, wallah, he's arrested. He couldn't pay his money, he couldn't pay his debt. That's the issue. Really? Yeah, okay. He took his riding beast, and he was very rich, Abdullah ibn Mubarak, very, very rich. He jumped on his riding beast, he went, he paid for the student and he left. The student got taken out and he met Abdullah ibn Mubarak. When he saw him, Abdullah ibn Mubarak said, how are you? He said, I'm good. Shaykh Abdullah ibn Mubarak said, where were you? He goes, Shaykh, I got imprisoned. Shaykh said, how did you get out? He said, someone paid, I don't know who it was. He goes, okay, mashallah. And never told him. So that's what the scholar has been, وَلَا أَنصَحَ لِلْأُمَّةِ مِنْ إِبْنُ مُبَارَكِ. There was no one who was more sincere in giving than Ibn Mubarak. Ibn Mubarak was so generous that he would come to a village and he would look at the people of the village and he would say, all of you guys, your hajj is on me. See, yeah, you're all going to go hajj with me. Abdullah ibn Mubarak. That's what the scholar, that's what the, Abdullah Abdurrahman Mahdi means. وَلَا أَنصَحَ لِلْأُمَّةِ مِنْ إِبْنُ مُبَارَكِ. He was sincere for the people. Abdurrahman Mahdi also said, رَأَى أَبُو إِسْحَاقَ أَسَّبِيعِ سُفْيَانَ الثَّوْرِ مُقْبِلًا. Abu Ishaq al-Sabi'i one day saw Sufyan al-Thawri walking, coming forward. And then he recited the ayah, وَأَتَيْنَاهُ الْحُكْمَ صَبِيًّا. This man has been given wisdom at a young age. And Sufyan al-Thawri. That's the praise that was given. Abu Yahya al-Himmaniyu, he said, سَمِعَ أَبَا حَنِيفَةَ. Abu Yahya al-Himmani said, I heard Abu Hanifa saying, لو كان سفيان الثوري في التابعين. If سفيان الثوري made it to the تابعين, لكان فيهم له شأن. They would have seen him as something amazing. Abdullah ibn Mubarak, he said, ما نعت لي أحد فرأيته. This statement is very powerful. He said, there was no one ever praised to me. Abdullah ibn Mubarak is saying, ما نعت لي أحد فرأيته. There was not a person who was ever praised for me. Then I saw that person, إِلَّا وَجَدْتُهُ دُونَ نَعْتِي, except I find him is lower than the praise that was mentioned about him. إِلَّا سُفْيَانَ الثَّوْرِيُّ, except to Sufyan al-Thawri. The praise and what I saw was greater. And he lived up to that standard. He died the year سَنَةَ إِحْدَى وَسِتِينَ وَمِئَةَ. He died 161 Hijriya. قَالَ حَدَّثَنَا سُفْيَانُ عَنْ أَبِي إِسْحَاقِ. The fourth narrator in this chain is Abu Ishaq al-Sabi'i. We touched on him before. His name is Amr ibn Abdullah al-Hamdani al-Kufiyu. We spoke about him. Dhahabi said, Al-Hafidh Shaykh al-Kufa wa'alimuha wa muhadithuha. He, rahimahullah, is min al-ulama' al-amilin. He's from the scholars who acted upon his knowledge. Wa min al-ajillati al-tabi'in. He's from the noble tabi'in. ثقة حجة بلا نزاع. ذهبي says وقد كبر وتغير حفظه. There's a mistake that many people fall into. They say Abu Ishaq al-Sabi'i had ikhtilat happened to him. And that's not right. He grew old and his memory wasn't as it used to be. Like an ikhtilat didn't happen to him. Dhabi refutes that. He says, وَقَدْ كَبِرَ وَتَغَيَّرَ حِفْظُهُ تَغَيُّرَ السِّنِّ وَلَمْ يَخْتَلِطْ. He just grew old, as we all are going to become old. And his memory was not sharp as it was when he was young. لكن he did not what? He didn't mix up his narrations. And he didn't become a person who was mixed up. اختلاط. And a lot of the muhaqiqeen, you find them writing at the bottom, Abu Ishaq al-Sabi'i mukhtalit, Abu Ishaq al-Sabi'i ikhtilat. That's not the case. That's important to point out. Even Dhahabi mentions in Sir Alamin Nubala, and I saw he mentioned in Mizan al-I'tidal. Another point that I wanted to mention here is the beauty of benefiting when you're young from your knowledge. Sufyan al-Thawri and Shu'bat ibn Hajjaj, Abu Bistam al-Ataki, they took knowledge from him when? Before he mixed up. Before he did mistakes in his narrations. وَلِذَلِكَ Bukhari and Muslim, they narrate from him through Thawri and Shu'bah. If I'm not wrong and my memory serves me right, Bukhari also sometimes narrates from the riwayah through Shu'bah. Through Sufyan ibn Uyayna from Abu Ishaq al-Sabi'i, Bukhari, if my memory serves me right. If Sufyan al-Thawri narrates from him, I said it's accepted. And if Shu'bat ibn Hajjaj ibn Bistam al-Ataki narrates it from him, is accepted. Because Sufyan ibn Uyayna is not. Why did Bukhari narrate from him? لِأَنَّ Bukhari, one of the things about Imam al-Bukhari is that he would go to a narrator who's weak sometimes. He would narrate from him, but he would choose the ones he got it right. You have to understand Imam al-Bukhari, his sani'ah, his tariqah. He does intikhab, he chooses. From those narrations, he got it right, he'll accept it. And some of the narrations, like Abu Zubayr al-Makki, for example, al-Bukhari, it's a qadiyya ukhra. Abu Ishaq al-Sabi'i and other people like that, we have to understand Bukhari, he chose from their narrations those which were right. And he dismissed those which were wrong. Abu Ishaq al-Sabi'i was born 2 years remaining from the khilaf of Uthman. And he met Ali ibn Abi Talib in giving khutbah. And I've already spoken about him previously in our previous hadith. The fifth narrator here is al-Baraa ibn Aazib radiallahu ta'ala anhu. We also spoke about him. Al-Baraa ibn Aazib, he is min a'yani al-Sahaba. He's from the noble companions. He narrated a lot from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he participated in many of the Prophet's battles. He came to the Battle of Badr, but he was told to go back. Him and Abdullah ibn Umar were both sent back. They were too young. Baraa ibn Aazib was too young. And Abdullah ibn Umar was also young. Bukhari narrated from Al-Baraa ibn Aazib 15 hadiths that I counted, and Muslim narrated from him 6 hadiths. He died and passed away, Al-Baraa ibn Aazib, sanat 72. 72 Hijriah. The sixth benefit, inshallah ta'ala, that I wanted us to take from the hadith is مَا رَأَيْتُ مِنْ ذِي لِمَّةٍ قَالَ مَا رَأَيْتُ مِنْ ذِي لِمَّةٍ. Ibrahim ibn Azim, he said, I haven't seen مِنْ ذِي لِمَّةٍ. Okay? The first point is مَا رَأَيْتُ. The word رَأَيْتُ sometimes is not used for رُؤْيَةُ الْبَصَر, seeing with your eyes. Sometimes the word Ra'a can sometimes mean يعني, to think or to believe. Like in here, we consider it مَا رَأَيْتُ, I haven't seen with my eyes. That's what it means. It doesn't mean I don't know. Sometimes it's used for I don't know. But here it means I haven't seen. Okay? مِن ذِي لِمَّةٍ. This word ذِي لِمَّةٍ, what is it? The statement of ذِي لِمَّة is talking about the hair, the length of the hair. There are 3 characteristics of the Prophet's hair described for us in the hadith of the Prophet's features. The first one is al-jumma. We're talking about bihasabi tulihi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in terms of the length of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, sha'r. There are 3 descriptions given to us. The first one is al-jummah. Al-jummah means ما سقط على المنكبين, that which falls onto the shoulders. The Prophet's hair went so far and it fell onto his shoulders, عليه الصلاة والسلام. The second one is al-wafra. Al-wafra means الشعر إلى شحمتي الأذن, when it reaches the earlobes. The earlobes. That's the second. And the last, the third one, which is al-limma, which is the one that was mentioned here. Al-limma means when it's below the earlobes and it hasn't also reached the shoulders. Some scholars, on the other hand, they said, no, it means also if it goes on the shoulders sometimes. That it can also be used as the limma. But if we use al-jumma to mean when it touch, when it drops on the shoulders, and we use al-wafra when it's on the earlobes here, then al-limma, it refers to ma dun al-jummati. It's what's, yani, it's above the shoulders, but not as far as the earlobes. All three of those are the description of the Prophet's hair. Those three are the ways that the Prophet's hair was. Sometimes his ears, his hair used to reach to his earlobe, alayhi salatu wasalam. Sometimes it was a bit lower than that, alayhi salatu wasalam. Went a bit further than that, but he didn't reach his shoulders. And sometimes they actually touched his shoulders, alayhi salatu wasalam. None of the descriptions mention that we went below the shoulders, alayhi salatu wasalam. The seventh benefit that we want to take from the hadith is في حلة حمراء. The narration mentions حلة الحمراء. في حلة حمراء أحسن من رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. This wording الحلة, it's always referring to two cloths, two garments. حلة, when you see it, Nawawi mentioned in شرح صحيح مسلم, he says قال أهل اللغة, the people of the language, they said الحلة لا تكون إلا في ثوبين. The word حلة, it's a garment that's got two pieces. And غالباً, majority of the times, it's referring to إزارٌ وريدان. There's a lower and an upper garment. Basically what we wear in ihram. There's an إزار at the bottom, and there's the رداء that goes on the top that you wear. That's what أهل اللغة say. Why is it called حلة? The reason is because يحلُّ على الآخري. You throw both sides over yourself like that. That's why it's called. It's not a sewed garment like that, but it's something you throw both sides like that. And the bottom the same way. Here, brothers, we have a discussion, which we already touched on, which I will repeat. Here we have the Prophet ﷺ wearing red. في حلة, the Prophet is in a garment, which is حمراء. But the Prophet ﷺ, sometimes he used to wear two cloths. يعني one رداء and a إزار. That's what حلة. And then it says حمراء. How do we reconcile this with the hadith Bukhari and Muslim both narrated min hadith Baraa ibn Aazib, where he said nahana an-nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam 'an al-mayathiri al-humri, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he prohibited us from wearing the clothing of mayathir, that's red. The Prophet prohibited us from wearing red. I already spoke about the discussion Shawkani brought forward, that Shawkani responded to Shawkani responded to Ibn al-Qayyim. Ibn al-Qayyim here, he said that hullatul hamra, it means that the Prophet wore red, but the red wasn't pure red. Okay, Ibn al-Qayyim said that. He said that the Prophet is wearing red, and what he prohibited is pure red. Like in Muhammad Ali Shawkani said, this is not pleasing to me. He said that the Sahabi Baraa ibn Aazib, is he not an Arab? He is. He said red. If he wanted to say red mixed with another color, he could have said it, Shawkani said. Okay? But we already discussed that in more details in our previous hadiths. The view that inshallah ta'ala we're just going to strengthen for now, and not go into more technical details, is that the humur, the red, is as long as it's not khalis, just pure red. If it's mixed with other colors, it's fine inshallah ta'ala, like white or black or something like that. There's no problem with that. But if it's pure red, then we say the hadith in Sahihain, where he's Baraa ibn Aazib, and he said, "Nahana an-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam 'an al-mayathir al-humri." And if it's got other colors in it, then we say the permissibility comes from the hadith of also Baraa ibn Aazib, which is the Prophet wore hullatul hamara sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The eighth point is أحسن من رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم.
فإذا طلبت من العلوم أجلها فأجلها منها مقيم الألسن.
The word أحسن is a مفعول ثاني grammatically. Is a second مفعول. وقوله في حلة. And the word where he said في حلة is one of two grammatical rulings. It's either a sifa for the limma or it's a ظرف for لرأيت, the word رأيت that we use. What does he mean, أحسن من رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم? I never saw anyone more beautiful than the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. In that clothing and that which he was wearing, I didn't see anyone more beautiful than him صلى الله عليه وسلم. And أحسن is a superlative, صيغة المبالغة, no one. Okay? Point number nine. له شعر يضرب منكبيه.
فإذا طلبت من العلوم أجلها فأجلها منها مقيم الألسن.
The word يضرب is a كناية. It's not صريح. It's a كناية. It's a figurative speech and it's used for الوصول. It's to reach. له شعر يضرب. The word يضرب, it's not actually hitting the Prophet's shoulders, but it's, remember when you walk, what happens? The hair jumps, so it hits your shoulders. This actually means it's smacking the shoulders, but it's a kinaya, meaning it reached his shoulders. That's what it means. It's a kinaya, it's a figurative speech. Kinaya, brothers and sisters, is when the kalam is not sarih. Like Allah Ta'ala says, نِسَاءُكُمْ حَرْثٌ لَكُمْ فَأْتُوا حَرْثَكُمْ أَنَّا شِئْتُمْ يَوْمْ. Your women are like your garden. That's a kinaya, it's not direct. There are three grammatical rulings for this. Okay? The first one is, it's possible that it's a bayan for the limma. The second one is, it's a jumla musta'nifa, it's a new sentence. That's what second one. The third one is, it's possible that it is a khabar. The word kana was actually there and it's muqaddar, it was omitted from the sentence. So kana lahu sha'run, saying it like that is also possible. The word sha'run, the narration that I came across, it does mention sha'ar, sha'ar bi fath al ayn. That's the narration I came across. And that's how it came in the explanation of many of the shurah. They say, lahu sha'arun yadribu mankibay. Lahu sha'a. But there's no problem. Shaykh Abdurrazzaq al-Badr's copy, he chose to place a sukun on it and say, lahu sha'arun. Even though that's not what the shurah mentioned, like there's no problem we mentioned before. You can say sha'arun or sha'arun. They're both Arabic, grammatically, in the Arabic language, it's fine. The tenth point, inshallah ta'ala, is ba'idu ma bayna al-mankibayni. Lahu sha'arun yadribu mankibayhi ba'idu ma bayna al-mankibayn. There's two ways of saying it. You can say ba'id, or you can say bu'aid. Bu'aid is tasghir. You're making it small, like talib, you say tuwaylib. The Arabs generally do that. So here, ba'id, which is far, bu'aid, which is also, you're making it tasghir, but it means far. The meaning actually just means, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is what? Aridu a'la al-dhahri. It just means the upper part of his shoulders are far. You don't look it from the bottom, you go up here, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where the collarbone will be, that part of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's shoulders was spread out. So his arms were not in, they were spread out, alayhi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ba'idu ma bayna al-mankibayni. Both of his shoulders were far from each other. أَمَا بُعَيْدُ مَا بَيْنَ الْمَنْكِبَيْنِ. There is two grammatical analysis here. There's two grammatical أَوْجُهُ الْعِرَابِ. The first one is مَنْصُوبٌ, that it's مَنْصُوب عَلَى أَنَّهُ خَبَرُ كَانَ الْمُقَدَّرِ. And the second one is مَرْفُوع, because of it's a خَبَر, مُبْتَدَى, and the sentence, all of it, we're going to make it a sentence which is independent by itself. The last and final benefit here, inshallah ta'ala, which is the 11th benefit, is لم يكن بالقصير ولا بالطويل. لم يكن بالقصير ولا بالطويل. What does it mean, لَمْ يَكُنْ بِالْقَصِيرِ وَلَا بِالطَّوِيلِ? It means, أي كَانَ مُتَوَسِّطًا. The Prophet was in the middle. بَيْنَ الطُّولِ وَالْقِصَرِ. The Prophet ﷺ, he wasn't excessively tall. وَالْقِصَرِ, he's not short, عليه الصلاة والسلام. And this Ibn al-Qayyim took a very powerful benefit from it. The way Allah made the Prophet ﷺ in the middle of his looks is how Allah made the Prophet's personality like that. And it's the same way Allah made his religion like that. Everything about it was in the middle, عليه الصلاة والسلام. His religion is in the middle. وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا. When we read his hair, what did we say? His hair was not too curly and it wasn't too straight. It was in the middle. He wasn't too dark and he wasn't too light. He was in the middle. He wasn't too tall. He wasn't too short. He was in the middle. All of that. يعني نبي الله محمد, everything about him was in the middle. إفراط ولا التفريط. And Ibn al-Qayyim brought fawa'id regarding that. And no, كان متوسطا بين الطول والقصري. The Prophet was in the middle in all of that. لا زائد الطول. He wasn't excessively tall. ولا القصري. And he wasn't excessively short. ولكنه إلى الطول أقرب. But he was more closer to being taller, عليه الصلاة والسلام. يعني, this, by the way, which I'm going to talk about in great details, inshallah ta'ala, is that he was closer to height. Some scholars, they said that when you saw the Prophet from far, he didn't stick out from the rest of the people. When you came close to him, there was height to him, عليه الصلاة والسلام. I'm going to stop there, inshallah ta'ala. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect, it's from me, Shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are both free from it. Subhanak Allahumma bihamdi, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayh.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. How can you do a 2-second action right now that will give you a share of the reward of everything we're doing on this YouTube channel? Simple. Like this video and click subscribe. Why? It will allow YouTube to recommend our videos to other users. And imagine the huge amount of reward that could be waiting for you on the Day of Judgment if you did that with a sincere intention of spreading the Deen of Allah. You'll be rewarded for every single person who benefits from one of our videos as a result of your like or subscribe. That's an easy 2-second action that you definitely don't want to miss out on. Do it now, click like and subscribe, and don't forget to make that intention.